Salam semuanya. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Melinda. On behalf of FOSI Committee, it is my pleasure to welcome you here today in FOSI Online Talk Series. I hope you enjoy your lunch and ready to see the presentation. Amid this COVID-19 situation, I hope everybody doing well. Stay at home and keep physical distancing. I would like to extend my gratitude to our sponsor, Noble Energy Resources, for funding of this Zoom platform. With us together already joined the FOSI committee, Mas Ricky, our General Secretary of FOSI, Pak Herman, our advisor, and the rest will joining us soon. We're glad to inform you that we established the FOSI YouTube channel. We uploaded all the videos from previous talk already. And don't forget to subscribe and like the channel. And please enjoy the video. And today's talk will be uploaded as well. I would like to thank you for joining us and get ready to be excited for a while, because the topic to be discussed today is fresh from the oven, very interesting to discuss about zircon by today. This special presentation will tell you about the geology and tectonic of the Banda Arc, Eastern Indonesia, update from zircon age dating of the outer arc. Glad to inform you that the registered participants is about 200. We were waiting for the rest to joining us. Moving right along, it is now my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker. Really honored to have Pak Ade Kadarusman, PhD from PT AKGC Jakarta Indonesia and Geoscience Department of University of Indonesia. And he is also advisor CEO of PT Aneka Tambang. And many thanks for sparing your time this afternoon, Pak Ade. I believe most of you know him very well, met him, or maybe already have his useful publication. And Pak Ade, I believe we'll share, hopefully you can share the material later on, but we can discuss a bit later. If anyone need the material, please wait until the end of the session. We will send a bit later to you. So well, before I hand over to Pak Ade, as usual, please allow me to give some rules in order to make this meeting running smoothly. I would like to get your attention for a moment. First, I recommend all participants to mute the audio and switch off your video during explanation from presenter to maintain good connection. The presentation may be recorded for screening within the FOSI platform. A Q&A box can be found in the icon panels, usually at the bottom of your screen. Enter your name for the committee to collect after the presentation. It will be answered live later on by Pak Ade. Later, you might turn on your audio and video to deliver your question. And we are very flexible. Let's see how many questions raised during the presentation. And we will have a break in the middle of the presentation later on. So let's see how it goes. So well, ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy the talk and please welcome Pak Ade Kadarusman. Yes, please, Pak.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me. Yeah, jadi ngomong bahasa Inggris lagi. Terima kasih undangannya FOSI untuk bicarakan tentang topik baru. Kebetulan saya terakhir ini melakukan age dating, ya. Jadi saya coba update ke teman-teman. Ini pertama kali saya presentasi selain yang di Taiwan, ya. Jadi judul yang akan berikan adalah Geology dan Tectonic the Banda Arc, Eastern Indonesia, Update from the Zircon Age Dating of the Outer Arcs. Jadi kontribusi berasal dari teman-teman dari Departemen Earth and Planet Science, Pak Kaneko Sang, Ota Sang, pembimbing saya Sigunori Maruyama, Tatsu Sujimori Sang, Akira Sang, Okamoto, also kontribusi dari Pak Yan Sokrahluakan, juga Kathleen Hot, dan juga Pak Edi Sucipta. Jadi selama di lapangan, ya.
Ade, can you please speak English? There's a request from participant.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So I cannot move the slide. Sorry. Okay. Also, the recent works actually based on the my cooperation with the Professor Sun Lin Chung. He's the professor from Department of Geoscience, National Taiwan University, also the director of the Institute of Science, Academia Sinica Taipei. So, and during my work with the laser ablation ICP mass spectrometer, I got help from Hao Lingyi, Trai, Jia Ping, and all my colleague from Academia Sinica. Also, thanks to Professor Sigonari Maruyama, he allowed me to use our sample to analyze by Lasar Bayesian ICP mass spectrometers. Okay, this is my I got my PhD in Tokyo Institute of Technology, yeah, almost 20 years ago. So I am my from the ITB. Okay, so the I spent almost 8 years in Japan. In I postgraduate, I did my master, my PhD, and also the 2 years was postdoc in TTEH. And also I spent almost 2 years as the postdoc in Netherlands and also in Germany. After that, I working for mining company until now. I mean that I built my company for consulting firm. Okay, the outline of my talk is about the actually talking about the orogeny, discovery orogeny in Indonesia. Also geochronology. Between that, we do the geochronology using the geochron edge dating. So we this is the continued work. My work almost 20 years ago with the Timo Tanibar, Metamorphic Oak. So I was showing the my recent work in geochron uranium rich geochron edge dating. Actually, the idea 20 years ago, it's almost 20 years ago. So, I mean, I joined the Tokyo Institute of Technology under Professor Maruyama supervision. So the we working with the orogeny, actually, about the there's two type orogeny, TV and bird, classified to orogeny based on the subductions, oceanic plate is the Cordilleran type orogeny or the collision orogeny based on actually the continent collision. The orogeny means that we build a mountain formation the continental crust. Formation the regional metamorphic belt. Also, we have major orogenic belt or erosion and sedimentation. That's why, and that time, we select the collision type orogeny in Timor Tanibar belt during for my master and my PhD. This is the Timor Tanibar, or we calling the Banda Ak, located in eastern part of Indonesia, is a part of the collision orogeny, which means that to understand the collision type orogeny, whether in Alps, Himalaya, it's better to see the ongoing orogeny occurs in the Banda. This is the small larger map. It's the Banda Ak. Actually, the Banda Ak is the northern area of the Australian continental that heading to north or northwest. Actually, maybe next 20 or 50 years, 50 million years, will collide with the Sundaland continent. It means that we'll soon if we what is calling the understanding what's going on before the collision to continent. This is we can learn how the Alp Himalaya occurs right now. And then the previous one, sorry. So, at that time, so the Banda Ak is actually collision between the volcanic and continent. Volcanic between the Banda Ak and the continent, the Australian continent. For most of the working of that area, it is cited as the present-day analog of the ancient convergent plate boundary. Conversely, the present-day tectonic is in Indonesia may provide the inside the early tectonic event, the Alp-Himalayan collision system. Alp-Himalayan system is already collide, but in the Banda Ak is not collide. This means the Australian continent and the Eurasian continent. In between that two continents, there is many volcanic arc, or maybe oceanic basin and other the arc, island arc or something like that. So for example, in Himalaya, we have the Kohistan arc. Actually, maybe this Kohistan arc is the present day Banda arc right now. This maybe. That is the reason why we try to understand the questioning analog of the ancient contact and plate boundary and the Timor Taliban. For that, and 20 years ago, searching in 96, we conducted a series detailed mapping of intensive desktop study. So we're working in 96 until 1997. We with the other colleague from Tokyo Institute of Technology. We conduct three time a trip. One trip is spending almost 2 months in that area to collect the samples. All the samples and with the mapping, we did the mapping and we call the collected sample. All the samples send it to Tokyo Institute of Technology at that time. It's part of my master and my PhD thesis. So actually in the Banda is the five key feature of the Banda Arc, Banda Volcanic Arc, is sometimes we call it the inner arc. It's coming from the Bali, Flores, Weta, Rombang, and Banda. The second position is the Banda non-volcanic arc or outer arc. This is consists of the Sumba, Timor, Tanimbar, Seram, and Buru. This is the my study, the Banda non-volcanic arc or outer arc. So we're working in the metamorphic rock in the outer arc. Then is more going to the south is the Banda Sea Basin. In between volcanic arc or non-volcanic arc, we have the Banda Sea Basin, South Basin of Weather Deep, Timor Trench, and Australian Continent. So have to solve. This is the point out the in the arrow. This is the Banda volcanic arc. Can you see the arrow? Hello?
Yes, we can see, Pak.
Okay. This is the Banda volcanic arc. You see, it's coming from the Flores, going to Romang, and the Banda volcanic arc here. And the second tectonic feature is the non-volcanic arc, that's what we're calling the outer arc. This is Sumba, Timor, small island here, Tanimbar, through the Seram and Buru. So this is the outer arc. In between volcanic arc and non-volcanic arc, we have the basin, Sabu Basin and Weber Basin. So, and then there's the one of the tectonic feature is the Timor Trap. Yeah, it's coming from Java Trench and changing name become Timor Trap. It's the subducted Australian continental and then Australian continent. So, in that time, we're working mapping actually from West Timor to East Timor. And that time, East Timor is still part of Indonesian region. So we're working using the ship, we rented the ship, traveling from Kupang to Kai Island, and also by car and also by to reaching the area. And that time we're using the airplane from Ambon. So you can imagine we we use the ship traveling from Kupang to Kai, and stop in Okusi, stop in Atapupu, stop in Dili, collect the samples, stop in Kisar, Leti, Moa, Sumatra, Dai Island, and also the Labobar. The Ai Island is the most the island close to the Weber Deep, and so the Labobar Island is the island is also close to the Weber Deep. So it's almost we spend it total three trip. One trip is 2 months. So this is my face. Doing in 96, it's the old time. It's very hard in that time. Now, in that time, the area is not it's not very good in transportation, in condition, and whatever. Now maybe my bed is better. So this is our the team members. Professor Sigonari Maruyama is in Dili, in Kupang is our logistic. This is our ship, wooden ship. This is the rental wooden ship. We're traveling from Kupang to Kai Island. This is Kathleen Hout from Free University of Netherlands. So we're traveling. This is we stop in Dili. In that time is 96. So still fighting between Indonesia Army and Pretilin. So we visit ILO at the time. So this is the Jesus Christ statue. And that time still still built. So along this year is the very good metamorphic rock. is the one the best I have ever seen the metamorphic of. It's the recordings, the Dili metamorphic of or Ailio metamorphic of. It's very beautiful with the folded of the schistose. Yeah, and that time still open area because the just a new road developing a new road in that time. This is the we transport using the canoe, traditional canoe, taking the sample and mapping along the beach. It's the Leyte Island, it's ultramafic off, it's the Sleepy Banda Sea. We using the canoe transportation by you see, I'm only in the Indonesian. Other team is the Japanese and one is Netherlands. And that time we use the traveling using the Merpati CN212, southeast in Yamdena Island. And this is very beautiful area. We sometimes we time spending in the beach for taking overnight in the one the island and the one we're moving to the one island just stay in the night in the coastal area. This is the Kisar. This very skin mountain. This is the metamorphic rock in Kisar and this is the rip limestone in Kisar. And the bottom figure is the Moa Island with two hill, west hill and east hill. This is Moa is peridotite. It's the gunung we calling gunung kerbau is peridotite and the west hill is also the peridotite. So this is publication. During my work, I published at least one in the Gondwana Research. Three of them is in Gondwana Research and also in other publication. So I didn't talk more about this publication, but I will talk about the new edge dating. So our publication is lack of the edge dating. That's why, I mean, we try to looking university or institute to can provide the edge dating for our work. This is the one of the, unfinished research in my side. Okay, this is a summary of the purpose work. You can read my paper in Gondwana Research. So, I mean, the conclusion in that three papers in Gondwana Research, in other papers, in other publication, actually showing that the before the continent-continent collision, like the Australian and Eurasian, before to collide, actually the several collision occurred there. For example, in the Banda case, is the volcanic arc continent is precede the final continent-continent collision. The second is the metamorphic rock is exposed in that area must be expanded by tectonic processes impressed to the shallow crustal level due to the wedge extrusion. We're showing the later the figure. The exhumation of the metamorphic belt and orogeny started in the West Timor and migrated to the East. So we're showing later in the figure and we attribute the rapid uplift reborn in subducting the Australian continental crust beneath the Timor figured by the slab breakoff. This is our publication to talking the slab breakoff maybe 20 years ago. Okay, so this is the showing. This is our result. You see the figures? This is the outer arc. We divide this the stage of the collision into two, Timor stage and Tanimbar stage. Actually, Tanimbar stage is the early stage. And the Timor stage is the advanced stage or doming stage. This is the Australian continental crust and subducted Australian continental crust become buoyant because of the different density. The oceanic crust become detached from the continental crust. It means that this is post of the slab break off and the post the continental going up buoyant. That means the material continental self sediment here is moving to the surface, as we calling the exhumation. This is we calling this Tanimbar stage. The Timor stage is the continental ASEAN Continental ASEAN Continental is already active, already buoyant, close the surface. That mean material in the Australian continental shelf is not the axiom, but is uplifting. So it's different. The Tanimbun stage is the axiom. The Timor stage is doming, something like that. Yeah, this is the more clear. Is the upper figure showing the tectonic extrusion. So we calling is the exhumation stage. In the below is doma uplift, or we calling the doming stage. This is the idea why the metamorphic extruded in the surface. This is our result in several publication. You can read the detail, but I will not talking in detail here because already published some time ago. But we are talking the future, the direction our discovery, our result. This is we created three model continental arc pollution created in 96. So the Timor stage is already we call it the mature slab breakup is occurs already occurred, but in the Tanimbun stage it's not break up. The oceanic crust still attached in the continental, but the Timor they occur in doming stage, but in the Tanimbun is occur in exhumation stage. This is different between Timor and Tanimbun. Okay, this is our three dimensional model. Okay. This is the past, and I didn't work for more than 10 years for this area. And suddenly, last year, there's this new established cooperation between TITE, Tokyo Institute of Technology, and Academia Sinica Taiwan. And last year, I started to back to our campus. I left the TIT 2003, and then I'm back again 2018 to back to our to my campus, Tokyo Institute of Technology, to join again cooperation with Academia Sinica in Taiwan. And also I visit the Academia Sinica Institute of Science. I met with Professor Maruyama again. This is the Professor Sun Lin Chung, our host in the Taiwan. This is we discuss. This is the Timor. How we work together to continue our work in some time ago. To continue my idea to continue as a geochronology of the Banda Outer Arcs. Yeah, we start and I spending almost 2 years visiting Japan and Taiwan. I pay 3 months to finishing the continue work. Actually the sample collected in Timor. Timor to Tanimbun is for almost 20 years kept in the Tokyo Institute of Technology. And since 2018, all the sample moved to Taiwan. Now all the sample that I collected during 96 to 99 is kept in Academia Sinica Taiwan. That's why now I'm working with the Academia Sinica Taipei, Taiwan, to continue my work in the Banak, especially for the age dating. Okay, now I starting to select the zircon, all the samples. The zircon in ICP is different. Usually for the zircon age dating, it's using shrimp uranium lead dating. But in now, with recent technology, ICP mass spectrometer attached with laser ablation can analyze the zircon uranium lead. That's why I moved to Taiwan just to concentrate to working for geochronology dataset using laser ablation ICP mass spectrometers. And we success, we collect more than 50 samples and that to separate the zircon. And maybe now, until now, 2000 zircon already analyze because of our target actually 2000 zircon. Because of the COVID, I cannot back to Taiwan to continue to analyze. but maybe later this year or early next year we'll back to Taiwan to continue to complete the all GCON edge dating user using laser ablation ICP mass spectrometers. So this is the idea actually why the GCON is important for the orogeny. As they mentioned before, orogeny is not only mountain in building, also making continental crust recrystallization, making the large scale structural origins atau geology, also sedimentation, erosion, tarponation, sedimentation. It's, so the orogeny is the sign of the igneous petrology, metamorphic petrology, structural geology, and sedimentology. It's combined all the branch of the geology to understanding orogeny. One, the important one for the understanding orogeny is geochronology. Geochronology is the basic method to solve this topic. GCON is the one of mineral used for the geochronology. This is the idea that why I strongly continue working to dating the GCON. The idea, GCON can recrystallize during the process of the orogeny. For example, GCON is easy to make the rim. There's a several kind of the GCON growth recorded in the GCON. This means if we can see in the cathodic luminescence the different color of the GCON, this means that can showing the history of the orogeny. That means, for example, stage one is actually in the inner, stage two in the rim, the second rim, stage three can record it in the outer rim, stage four, the peak, can record it the most outer rim, and stage five is recorded in the most outer rim. This is the idea for the single GCON tell the history of the metamorphic stage. The we calling metamorphic stage, we understanding metamorphic, we understanding of the history of the mountain building. This is the idea. That's why we're working with the GCON. This is an example, the CL image of the GCON showing several of GCON growth. If we can date in the core and then we can dating the rim, in the each rim is the perfect. It's really perfect. The GCON can show the edge of the pre-peak, peak, and retrograde edge. The idea. This, the main problem is, for me, the good GCON dating is the SRIM uranium bead dating. It's the well-known. But it's so expensive. The beam size of the ion micron probe is can get 5 micron. Laser ablation, this beam size is the most larger. During my working in Taiwan, is the beam size is 30 micron, 6 times the beam size of same uranium bead. That's the problem. Of course, the laser disadvantage, kekurangan laser ablation itu adalah size beamnya terlalu besar. Jadi kadang-kadang kita tidak bisa mendating berdasarkan GCON growth-nya ya. This is the problem of the laser ablation because the beam size is too large. SRIM is the 5 micron inside, but the laser ablation ICP mass spectrometer is 30 or the 40 micron in the beam size. That's the problem. But of course, we'll try. Okay, actually, as the this is the idea when the metamorphic rock is the photoliths, for example, continental subsediment in the top and being subducted. Because the continental subductions, and because the continental is not subducted, and the the original rock continental sediment in the top and being subducted become the metamorphic rock in the depth, and then because the continent is unsubductable, and then become to exhume to the surface, so it means that the GCON edge can record it the protolith edge. Sedimentation edge atau igneous edge in the continent, and then the peak metamorphic edge, where in the depth during the subduction, and then exhumation edge, hydration in the top, and also the doming edge in the surface. At least we have the recorded three edge dating, edge history. The original, the detrital edge, peak metamorphic edge, and surface edge or doming stage, when the rock is exhumed or when the rock is uplifted in the surface. This is the graphic showing the temperature pressures. This is the showing metamorphic history. This is the original rock here, and being subducted become the peak metamorphic edge, and then retrogrades or exhumation or doming to the surface. At least we recorded one, the edge here, second edge here, and the third edge here. This is the idea using the zircon chronology. This is the we try to understanding the orogenic Colossian type and Pacific type. Okay. We actually Timor represent of the Colossian type. So we explain one by one here. This is our previous study. So we visit the East Timor, West Timor, East Timor, Kisar, Leyte, Moa, Sumatra, Dai, Babar, then Tanimbar. Here's the, we collect the sample from the West Timor, East Timor, Kisar, Leyte, Moa, Sumatra, Dai, and small island here, Labobar. We simplified the tectonostratigraphy of the Timor Tanimbar, become two large tectonostratigraphy. The below is unmetamorphosed continental self sediment. And then next Timor Tanimbar metamorphic unit, or we calling the Timor Tanimbar metamorphic belt. And the top is the arc of rhyolite, and the in the top is quaternary limestone. We simplified this kind of the tectonostratigraphy sequence. The West Timor, we focus is only on metamorphic rock and ophiolite here. In West Timor is the Mutis, East Timor Ailio, Lolotoi, Kisar, Kisar metamorphic rock, and Leyte, Leyte, in Moa, Sumatra, and also the Labobar. In Babar, we couldn't find Dai, and Babar, we couldn't find of metamorphic rock. Dai exists the gabbro, Babar is only composed of unmetamorphosed continental self sedimentary unit. This is the our idea for the arc of rhyolite. We collecting the of rhyolite rock, yeah, consists of the basalt, gabbro, and peridotite. Now we'll explain one by one about the our result of geochronology. We showing first is the Mutis region. This is our mapping in the Mutis. We collected sample here in Mutis area. Here is the figure here. The geological map is modifying from the previous author. Then in West Timor we visited the Mutis, Okusi, and Atapuping. And Timor, East Timor, we visit Dili. Yeah. Okay, this is we collect at least in Timor four locality: Mutis, Okusi, Atapupu, and Dili. Here is the Mutis River, is the edge dating of the Mutis. We collect the sample, is the number sample is A. Listen here. This is the result of the, you see, this is the zircon collected in one section. So we automatic analyze using laser ablation, one zircon, one point. This is continuous to analyze in one sample. Like this is one sample, is about maybe 30 to 50 grain of zircon. Actually, zircon separated in the China, in Beijing Institute. This is expert for separating zircon from the rock. So we have, it's not, we trust of the Beijing Peking Institute to separate the zircon. We have the collaboration with the Peking University to separate zircon. Then the result of separating zircon, we process in the Taiwan. Then we make the epoxy resin, and we cut in the slab, and we diamond polish and analyze in the Taiwan for laser ablation ICP mass spectrometer. So we analyze this, okay, using random lead program. So this is one example skis from the Mutis. Result edge is from Cretaceous to Paleozoic. Then it's amphibolite. Also, this the youngest edge is 9.8 million years, the oldest age is also Paleozoic. Is the result? So we have the Ignis age using the hafnium is isotope. We predict the whether it's the metamorphic or the Ignis zircon. The other age may be inherit age or the trital zircon is coming from the original protolith of the age. It's also the amphibolite. Is the 9.8 is the metamorphic age. That means the age of that metamorphic in the mutis is very young. It's about 10. But also they have the age 15 to 46 and also the much older Cretaceous to Paleozoic. This showing this is of course Concordia line is not very good. This is the problem of the laser ablation ICP mass spectrometers. This is the granulite. We have 80 million years. Calcite granulite with 50. This is many range age. This is the Concordia. This is the Cretaceous. This is some the peak. The Cretaceous age and much older. Paleozoic age is also scattering there. This is mean the Paleozoic age is the trital age. Also the mutis, parenthetic case, with dating, the same. The result is almost same with the previous. This is more the showing the sample showing more the detrital age or the original age coming from Australia. And we're working also with Okusi Atapupu. So Atapupu over quartzite in Atapupu showing detrital age. There is no record of metamorphic age. This is the quartzite. So the peak, the population, the age is about Cretaceous and some the Paleozoic age. And also in paleolithic case, resulting the young age in between 5 to 13 age million years, and some also the detrital age. Even more Paleozoic here. Yeah. Okay. So this is the distribution of the edge range. So we have the in paleolithic case we have the three edge range, Cretaceous edge and Mesozoic and also to Paleozoic edge, Mesozoic edge and also Paleozoic edge. This is showing of all the detrital edge. However, in the one the paleolithic case recorded the young edge. This is metamorphic age. Also, we're working with others, granulite age, mapic granulite is showing the two kind of age clusters. Okay, same, yeah. But we also analyze the igneous rock, rhyolite. Showing the rhyolite is the young age, similar with the igneous, similar with metamorphic rock age. This is coincident, yes. Okay, and this mapic granulite and the amphibolite also showing the metamorphic age. Also, we're working with Dili. We collect the Dili sample, is the Aleo metamorphic rocks. We analyze three samples and from Dili, four samples actually. One sample is not still waiting for the finish. This is the metamorphic grade of the Dili Aleo formations. So I'm showing the Dili showing the detrital age. It's amazing. We try to analyze one G-con with one G-con with showing two different image. Same, we see still same age. It's the Paleozoic age. Okay, it's also Dili. Dili have amphibolite with the young age. This metamorphic age. Similar with the Atapupu and the Mutis. There's some young age, below 10 age. Yes, it's interesting. But this is the quartzite from Dili. This is the sizolin detrital and anherit age. This is normal, it's coming from Australian. And Kisar, small island near the Timor-Leste. We collect the sample in the Kisar Island also. We analyze a sample, three samples, showing the Kisar is showing almost all is the inherited age or detrital age. this Mesozoic to Paleozoic, distribution of the Gikkon in the Gikkon Age in the Quasit in Pisa, and also is amphibolite. So we analyze both paleolithic case and basic case, try to understand it. Paleolithic case recorded the detrital age, but the basic case, perhaps we expect that is the igneous, metamorphic age. But this is showing the amphibolite still showing the detrital or inherited age. This is amphibolite, this is also Cretaceous. We analyze also in Leyte Island. Yes, this is the, we collecting sample almost 600 sample in from Leyte. We develop the regional metamorphic cone. This is my master thesis here. This is we analyze the sample for the Leyte. And Leyte is quite good. Some is showing the younger age, but also difficult to interpret because the large distribution from the Miocene age to Paleozoic. Of course, the Paleozoic is inherited or detrital age. This is the Mica's case, detrital Gikkon age, and also the paleolithic is showing also same with the detrital age, and amphibolite is showing the amphibolite origin. Okay, sorry, metamorphic origin. Carbosilicate rock is the coming from limestone or calcareous sandstone, showing the more younger age. Yes. And also the Moa. We analyze the Moa Island sample. It's only one sample here. Mica series showing detrital age. The Moa is the peridotite. We're calling the West Hill, East Hill, and the West Hill peridotite. I don't know now Moa. Now I heard that Moa become the regency, more civilized now. This is the Moa series. Showing all it's like the detrital age. Sumatra not analysis yet. We're still waiting for the age dating. Dai Island is the island close to Weber Deep, to Bender Basin, to Weber Deep. So this figure showing the Quaternary Rift Limestone. This figure is showing the gabbro. This is mostly the gabbro. The gabbro, I was showing later and maybe die. I missed the age dating. And the latter is the small island, northern part of the Yamdena Island, we're calling like Bobber Island. We have the metamorphic rock. There is also the edge is the Cretaceous to Paleozoic, which is the same. So we analyze the paleolithic case in Bobber Island. This is the cluster edge. The summary, we have the three cluster edge of dating. So we at least we have the metamorphic Gikkon, we have the igneous Gikkon dating, we have the detrital Gikkon, and this is we have three cluster of Gikkon dating below plus minus 10 million age. This is the metamorphic Gikkon. We have the red Cretaceous Gikkon grain. Originally, some of them is the igneous rock based on the hafnium isotope. The older jet, the older age, like the Mesozoic, Paleozoic, is the detrital Gikkon or inherited Gikkon from the protolith rock. It's coming from Australia or something like. So, based on our study, we conclude we have three cluster of age dating for the metamorphic rocks in the Timor Tanima rock. So, the summary on Gikkon age dating. One, the cluster is below 10 million years. From the hafnium isotope, recorded metamorphic age for the metamorphic rocks. Also, igneous origin for the igneous rock. We analyze some of the igneous rock. Then the last Cretaceous age recorded in the metamorphic rocks, some of them are showing the igneous age origin based on the hafnium isotope. And then the latter, the other Gikkon age, Paleozoic age, recorded in the metamorphic rock as the detrital age or inherited Gikkon. It's very interesting. At least we have three peak of the age below about 10 million years, Red Cretaceous, and then on the Gcon edge. So this is the geocondition summary of metamorphic peak rocks. We have about 10 million year Gcon, metamorphic rock, and the igneous rock, igneous age, late Cretaceous. It's not really clear. Some of them is the igneous age. It's very interesting. There's some metamorphic which is young origin, based on the is the igneous rock origin, but the more younger age compared with other age. And then the third age is Paleozoic Gcon. It's detrital. Yes. And also the we have also analyzed the igneous rock, gabbro and granite, is similar age. Almost 10 million years similar with the metamorphic rock age. This is the example, the dating igneous rock is granite, gabbro in Atapupu. The gabbro mostly 8 or 6. It's very interesting. Gabbro, dolerite, rhyolite, granite, it's mean plagiogranite. It's close to age of the metamorphic rock. Yes, about 10 million age. So my previous work with the geochronology of the this area using potassium argon and argon argon in Labobar and Reti, the age is more older. It's about 40 to 12 age using argon argon. The previous study, for example, Buru, Seram, Timor, and West Timor. So unfortunately, I not yet compare with the previous author, mostly from the East Timor, and some work already done. I have not yet compiled with the some the Gcon edge coming from the Australian or the British. But this is my preliminary conclusion because it's the first time I showing this the edge dating my work in this talk. It's not yet showing to others, rather than when I showing in Taiwan. So just I need the what is calling the input from and others from the audience. Yes, my idea is actually it should be younger age to the east because in Timor is already doming, I mean already uplifting, but in the Tanimbar stage is the young just. Exhume, not yet just the what is called in the early stage of the exhumation, but in the Timor Island is already doming state. So between my idea is the metamorphic edge in the Timor is more older and metamorphic rock in the small island to Tanimbar. So this is my concluding remark. This is my recent publication in the Gondwana Research 2010. This is my the tectonic subduction tectonic idea cartoon. So with correlation with my previous study in Gondwana Research, I thought that the Gcon chronology is showing the youngest age of between 8 to 10 million age relative to subduction or maybe exhumation age. Now we're working now to understand meaning of the other age. With looking the petrological, we're working with the sample. Also, we try to connect it with other relevant age dating in the region. Thank you. This is my talk in for the age dating. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Ade, for the interesting presentations. Very comprehensive, very very challenging, yeah. Very challenging work. Okay, now we will have questions and answer session, discussion sessions. There's still one from Pak Herman, yeah. We still have many slots for question. If you want to have question, please put your name here in the chat box, yeah. We still have many times for the discussion. And Pak Ade will be very happy to have input, yeah, for from us, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
The first one is from Pak Herman, please, Pak Herman. Yeah.
Okay, Pak Ade, very impressive work. I worked on Banda Ak many times, but never been to those islands you mentioned. Yeah. I think the first, I see there's not too many questions. I have many questions. But maybe for the first stage, I want to ask clarification first. Yeah.
Yeah.
You mentioned about different stages, different timing from when you do the zircon. You look at the core, the mantle, and the rim. Yeah. So is it true that the core, actually talking about the original material age, and the mantle talking about metamorphic peak, and the rim is actually the dominating?
Yeah.
Is it like that?
Yeah, actually the idea, I'm looking that kind of zircon with two different stages or different feature in the cathode Limonson CL. But actually when I dating one single zircon with two different color, the edge is not really clear. Sometimes different color with the same edge range. Sometimes one in the other one, the in the core is the Paleozoic, in the rim is Cretaceous. So actually my target to looking the one zircon with many rim, with many growth, zircon growth.
But then, if you have many zoning, then how do you interpret that one?
That this is what I'm showing in the graphic, showing the in the exhumation state, in the pressure temperature curve.
Mm.
In core is the original dating, original age. Maybe it's coming from the original from the Australia, and then okay. The zircon, again, the rock is subducted, making the new rim or new growth, rimming the other one is the peak metamorphic age, and the rock is exhumed to the surface. Another rim, another the zircon growth. So, okay. So this is my expectation. I have the single zircon with two different age. But unfortunately, zircon here is too small, and our method laser ablation ICP mass spectrometer, the beam size is too larger, 30 micron.
Okay.
That's why I use the just statistic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just the I that's why I using the statistic. Just I analyze many zircon, and then we will showing maybe. One zircon is showing only the latest zircon growth, something like that. Yeah.
Okay. So then the next question: if you have a picture of a series of samples, yeah, what is the size of those samples actually?
The sample of zircon?
Yeah.
Actually, our zircon is too small. Actually, the size of zircon is from. Say 50 micron to 200 micron.
Okay, but the one you put in the picture, it looks like you have several photos.
Yeah.
That is actually a printout of your microscope pictures. Is it correct?
Yes, right.
Okay. So if you have a wide distribution age, how do you determine the age of a particular event? You make a statistic, or
yeah,
you make
average? First, because the I will combine all the zircon age. It's almost 2,000 zircon age. But first, I have to select one by one, because this is the time consuming to select one by one, because I afraid one of the age is just maybe the beam size, actually the dating two kind of zircon growth. That's the mistake. That's why the Concordia is outside the Concordia line. So the next step for me is select from 2000 zircon age, become the good one, and then we're making the statistic for the whole region. It's the next step.
Okay.
But at least with this stage, we got three kind of the cluster age.
Okay.
Yeah. I still waiting because our sample is only 30 sample zircon. I still waiting 20 zircon age.
Okay.
So 20 zircon sample. Maybe okay. Because the corona is I have to back to Taiwan.
Yeah.
To analyze again, but because the COVID, I stop
to back to Taiwan. I should be ahead to Taiwan spending maybe one month to finishing the work. But at least I showing the permanent result. So I have to get some idea from the audience.
Okay, I have more questions, but I see somebody raise their hand, so I give other people first to ask question. I come back later. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Pak Herman.
Thank you, Pak Herman. The next we have Pak Awang. Yeah. Pak Awang, you can turn on your audio, please.
Yeah. Hello, Pak Ade.
Hello, Pak Ade, Pak Awang. Oh, udah lama nggak ketemu nih ya.
Yeah. Not long to see. Thank you, Pak Ade, for detail presentation on zircon geochronology. I have several questions. You group the geochronology of zircon into three periods, yeah?
Yeah.
Maya to Pliocene, Cretaceous, and Paleozoic. For Paleozoic, I think it is usual we have the detrite zircon because Timor, some of the materials come from Australia, maybe that's related to the Australian materials for the Paleozoic.
Yeah.
For the Maya Pliocene, you apply the tectonic setting related to the exhumation because of we have the slab break off, yeah?
Yeah.
In Timor, which is younger age to the east.
Yeah.
For the Cretaceous, have you explanation for that? For the group of Cretaceous zircon? For the Cretaceous, you're still working on that?
Yeah, still working to understanding because the Cretaceous is the showing the igneous origin based on the hafnium isotope. Some is not the some of the metamorphic origin. Yeah, that is still I'm still working for the Cretaceous age. What's the meaning that? Yeah, this is for understanding is the young age related to recent subduction zone. I mean exhumation, but the older is related with the Australian protolith. That is the Cretaceous. I'm still working on to understanding this cluster age. Yeah.
Okay, Pak Ade. The second question is related to the age of the exhumation, which is, to your opinion, is younger to the northeast, or east. Yeah. Last week we have a webinar also about Timor with Tim Salden, and I asked a question about why in West Timor we have many mud volcanoes, but in Timor Leste lack of mud volcanoes. Yeah, and Tim Salden answered that maybe we have deep erosion in East Timor, so most of the mud volcano have been eroded. So it means that maybe the collision, the age of the collision in East Timor is earlier, was earlier than that of the West Timor. This is a bit controversy with your which is older in West Timor than that of the East Timor. What is your opinion on that, on this, Pak Ade?
Yeah, because I using the data of the to understanding the active stage. I using study the previous work for the rip limestone study of the active from the rip limestone, showing the advance of the rip limestone is coming from the West Timor. And then less in the East Timor and more less in the small island. Study of the uplift of the rip limestone because rip limestone recorded of the uplifting domain, something like that. Mm-hmm. So the thickness of the rip limestone in the West Timor is highest compared to the East Timor. This means that the uplift or domain stage in the West Timor is more advanced compared to East Timor. I have the previous presentation, actually. I have the previous idea to explain that. Yeah. Because in West Timor, in already slum break off, but in the Tanimbar or small island, it's just starting to detach the oceanic crust to continental crust. Yeah.
If we have a late exhumation to the east, it means that the age of the oceanic plate that the subducted was younger, to the east.
That's right. Yeah, this is the idea. But unfortunately, our geocon edge is not showing that. I mean, we have to working kind of understand why is the my previous idea is not fit well with the geocon edge. Yeah, this is need. I still waiting for 20 sample geocon edge for different area. Yeah.
Okay, but the last question is about the Weber dip. The Weber Rip is the deepest point in Indonesia. Yeah, it yeah. it reaches up to the more than 7 kilometers. Yeah.
Yeah.
More than Bandasi itself.
Yeah.
Several weeks ago, we have also a webinar in Fosse with the Robert Hall, and they have the thing from the group that maybe we have something collapse because of we have some detachment, yeah, beneath the Weber Deep. So maybe by the uplift of the outer arc, and then we have also we have the spreading of the Bandasi, and then we have the collapse that may be related to some detachment underneath the Weber Deep. What is your opinion with your colleague also ever thought about the origin of Weber Deep, which is very deep, even deeper than the Bandasi?
Yeah, actually, the idea, like I showing actually in the figure here, in the, let's see. Can you see the figures?
Yes,
okay.
Sure.
Yes, okay. Okay, this is. Yes, in this one.
Okay.
Yeah. The idea of the Weber Peak is the extensional. Yeah, it's the opening of the pore arc. Pore arc basin.
Yeah, pore arc. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, because the extensional. This is the idea. My previous idea is the Weber is just the, opening of the pore arc basin. Something like the idea. I mean, the reason why this the pore arc. This opening pore arc is still. Need to. To solve. Yeah. The first idea is like this, but maybe it's the idea is the plume, mantle plume. This is the crazy idea. Mantle plume. Push the. The Weber bit become the opening something like that. This is the CG idea. For me, the Weber tip is the extensional because what is calling the because the bend of the Banda arc, and then post that the pore arc basin is opening.
Yeah, something unusual, yeah, for arc to have the spring because usually the drifting is in a back arc basin, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. This is yeah.
Okay, we.
Yep.
Maybe Pade and Kalik should be still working on Okay, thank you, Pade and Ricky. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you, Pak Awal. Thank you, Pak Ade.
Yeah.
Next question from Pak Sukahar Eka.
Hello, Pak Ade.
Yeah.
How are you? Good?
Yeah, fine, Pak. Yeah.
Semoga baik-baik saja. Yes, interesting question, Pak Ade. I have some question for you regarding your presentation. The first question I think related to the previous question from Pawang. I wonder about the rip limestone. I miss your slide. Yeah. Could you show please again the correlation between rip limestone to the older unit?
Yeah. I have the. In different presentation, it's not here actually. I have to find another file. It's not.
Yeah.
It's not here.
I wonder about the relief limestone. It's related to the exhumation.
Yeah. As better. I have stock still here.
Okay. Just take your time.
Yeah. Okay. Okay,
it's
this one.
Could you share screen, please?
Not yet.
Oh, yeah.
Not yet.
It's coming.
Okay, here. One idea. Kata enggak?
Ya, ada Pak. Ya,
kelihatan.
Ya.
Okay, jadi this is my previous the idea is I did in my master thesis. Just I make the compilation about the replying stone. So this is the recorded of the elevation.
Okay.
And also recorded of the uplift rate.
Okay.
Our vertical movement. This is the compiled data from Rosidi, Bahari, Agustia. This is
okay.
Yes. Yeah. This is the thickness of the thickness the rip limestone in the West Timor reached 2,000 meters, but in the 1,200 something.
200. Yeah.
Yeah. But the small island Tuntanimbar is more lower level. That this is mean that uplifting stage in the West Timor is already advanced or more faster in the East Timor and also compared with other islands. Yeah.
Okay, so did you got the edge of the rip limestone as well?
Yes. I just from the fossil actually coming from the paper of Peter Pinci and also Chapler. I forgot because it's already 20 years ago. This is I have the comparison.
Okay. So can I have another question, please?
Okay.
You mentioned that the older zircon you got the Paleozoic. Could you give more detail? And for the future work, you said you're not finished working in zircon, right? So
yeah.
Do you have any idea in the Timor, will you got the Precambrium age? I mean, age like Protozoic or something?
Yes, I did. I got the Protozoic age. The other one is reached almost Archean age.
Archean age
is 3,000 million, yeah, 3,000 something.
So you got 3,000 and 2,000 as well?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
Of course, but it's that title, it's the inherit, it's coming from the Australian.
Yeah, so because actually I'm doing zircon as well at the moment, yeah.
Yes.
At the Bedhead region, Kepala Burung, Pak. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And I got the data. The older one for my data is 2000 something.
Okay.
So it's around Paleo Proterozoic or something. So
yes.
I think we can combine. Combine from my research area in the Bedhead with yours. Yeah.
Yeah. This is the oldest age is coming from the late Kisara Island.
Okay.
Yeah, from the quartzite. So Kisar Island is almost 3,000 million age. It's the oldest.
Oh, it's the oldest. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Pak Adek. So I hope we can catch up later. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Adek.
Bye. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Sukahar. The next is from Pak Win. Yeah. And also, we still have many slots for questions. You can put your name here in the chat box, please. Pak Win, you can turn on your audio, please.
Hello, Adi.
Yeah.
Great presentation. Thank you very much. Very, very comprehensive.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
I'd like to follow up kind of quickly because Awan came in on part of my thought. If you come around the corner of the Banda Arch and you're looking at the timing of, let's say, Seram relative to Tanimbar, are we going to continue this sort of progressively younger age, or is it possible that Tanimbar and Seram are about the same time? I'm just kind of coming around the whipping corner and with kind of like a relative age. Thank you very much.
Yes. Actually, the young age in the Seram, as they were pointed out by the Pono, the publication by Pono in the granulate, is the same age with perhaps in the eastern part of the Banda. Yes, like the Tanimbar or small island. Yes, as I, because some of the agon-agon dating already done in the serum, also the deepon age, showing the young age. But it's, I guess it's most younger compared with the small island. Yeah, I guess it's about 4 to 6 million age. But in the youngest age in the eastern part of the Banda Ak, like in the Labubar or in other small island, is the youngest age is about 8. Yes, I guess it's the going to the edge of the Banda Ak or the curve. Yes, it's more. It should be more younger. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Win. Actually, I have one question, Pak Ade, if I may.
Yeah, right.
Pak Ade, I remember when I visit Timor, there is a very widespread melange. Yeah, we call it Bobonaro melange. Yeah, Bobonaro melange. Do you have any opinion about that? How does it form? And is there any evidence from the zircon data, Pak Ade? Thank you very much, Pak.
Yeah, actually, I'm working for the Banda Outer Arc. This is focus is only metamorphic rocks and also the igneous rocks. So I didn't have any sample of the sedimentary cover of that region. Okay. Yeah, that's just, I have no idea. Actually, I visit actually the Bobonaro melange. Yeah, but I can recognize that usually the matrix of the melange is consists of two. It's my when I the first one is the gold mesh or matrix of the melange is consists of the serpentinized rocks or clay or low grade clay rocks, but in case of the Timor is not serpentinized, it's not the low grade metamorphic rock like the clay scaly clay or something like that. It is just mud.
Okay.
Yeah, this is just the recent mud. This is my thought. It's completely different with melange I saw in Sulawesi.
So do you think it's like oleosostrom?
No? Yes, right.
Oh, okay. So it's like sedimentary, yeah?
Yeah, okay. Sedimentary, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Okay. I think Pak Herman, yeah? Pak Herman, have any further question, yeah? Pak Herman, you can ask again.
Okay, next question to Pak Ade. Now more about discussion, I guess. Maybe first question, this zircon can also determine the provenance of the grain,
yeah,
the stores.
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah. This is actually, I still working with the hafnium isotope. And okay. Also, I'm still working with the other isotope.
All right.
Yeah. And when I got the data from the zircon isotope, I can tell the history. That is, where's the zircon coming? This is okay. Still working. Still. So, because the COVID, I stopped to visit the Taiwan.
Yeah.
Actually, I have to working to continue. Yeah. So, I'm working with the chemistry of the zircon, red element. And also the isotope hafnium, and also it's hafnium. I forgot the one the isotope is. Right.
So when you do this study, do you have any collaboration with Robert Hall and other institute in Australia? Because I know, like when I met John Decker from NICO, they collect a lot of zircon dating, zircon samples, and they do a lot of dating. And then he actually give the data samples to Royal Holloway. Mm-hmm. And the idea is to integrate with the database, zircon database in Australia, to make a reconstruction of the eastern Indonesia. And when I talked to him, initial result saying that the zircon they have from eastern Indonesia, the microplate, you know, from Buru and so on, they actually suggest that the zircon coming from the eastern part of Australia. So they actually migrate all the way to the west, controlled by the Sorong Fault, kind of like a proto-Sorong Fault, something like that. Do you have any idea about that, then?
Yes, actually, the first, we are a different group actually. I mean, our group Tokyo Institute of Technology and is competitor with the Royal Hardware Group. It's always, I mean, disagreement if the idea is something like that. That's it. Mm-hmm. Of course, this is a good idea to combine of the data. Actually, in our TIT have the GPON database, so I have it in my laptop, but not yet integrated. Of course, I interested also with join with the GCON database with other groups, yes, like the Australia or something. It's very interesting, yes. I would like to cooperate combine all the GCON's database, yes. Right. This is very good, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's the discussion about how much material from moved by the present day Sorong and the proto or paleo Sorong fault, because we know there's a lot of thing coming.
Yeah,
and then actually this, as you see on your map, the Irian Jaya, the bird head, is only the remain, because a lot of things are already gone.
Yeah.
So they many of those actually probably located in Sulawesi or Bangasula.
Mm-hmm.
That's the thing they want to reconstruct back. So yeah, this database can be integrated, so then maybe a new story will come up from the region.
That's right, it's very interesting, because I mean, yes, some of group is keeping the database, not the sharing with other, but it's not very good. Yes, I open to combine all the database for the GCON dataset, the estate.
Then maybe question to Padi again. So I know you are focusing like the inner part of the Banda Ark. Yeah? So and people from the petroleum, like myself, we are actually looking for the outer part of this Banda Ark. Talk mainly about the sedimentary rocks, yeah? Because we are looking for petroleum. I wonder what kind of things we can support or contribute to your study, if there is any. So then we can call, I remember when I tried to make it just a simple cross-section of West Timor, it's very difficult because I see the northern part of Timor, mainly talking about volcanic and metamorphic.
Yeah.
The geologists have different concept compared to the one the south. In the south, mainly done, the cross-section done by petroleum geologists, sedimentary geology, also have different concepts. So, but I just wonder if, since we have this forum, maybe we can see how we can integrate. So my question to you, how can we from the petroleum community help you, if anything that can help?
Yeah, yes, it's a very good idea, because and that time when I stay in the Tokyo Institute of Technology, our interest is really pure tectonic. It's to try to understanding the orogeny. Of course, actually part of them, our study can mix with the study from the petroleum side. Yes, this is agree. When the showings, the seismic profile or something like that, it's really helped me to understanding the size of the igneous or metamorphic rock. This is the very helpful for us to understand, because we just collect the sample in the surface, but we don't know yet the size or the configuration of that kind of rock, and also connection with the sedimentary rock both in the underline the metamorphic rock, or also in the covering the metamorphic rock. Yes, sir. I'm really interested to working together for that kind of opportunity. Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, Pak Herman, thank you. Sorry, we have one last question probably before we close the question discussion from Pak Deka, yeah. Dominicus Deka. You can turn on your audio, please.
Right. Yeah. Hello, Pak Ade.
Yeah, hello, Pak Dika. Yeah.
Yeah. So, thank you so much for the new how to say new. I learned a lot of about especially about metamorphic rocks in this part. And actually, I wonder about is those zircon are from all are from metamorphic rocks? I wonder about is all of those zircon are from metamorphic rocks?
Yes, I mean metamorphic rock is actually have the photolith.
Yes. Yeah.
The photolith mean is any kind of photolith, sedimentary rock, igneous rock, or even metamorphic rock itself. It mean yes, that's if the photolith is sedimentary rock, that the zircon S, the other zircon S recorded of the sedimentary rock S, or not, maybe not sedimentary because the sedimentary cannot make the zircon growth. Let me maybe the more the origin like the igneous rock or metamorphic rock something like that. Yes, what is calling the zircon edge can record it the original one, but also can record it the timing of sedimentation. For example, if we have the two peak edge, for example, 200 million edge, 100 million edge, 200 yes. million edge is the edge of the igneous. 100 edges, the edge of the metamorphic. In between is maybe the edge of sedimentation or erosion, something like that.
So another more question is, if those zircon are from metamorphic rock, so I was wondering about how much is the pressure and temperature condition of those rock. So I'm just thinking about, so which means if we can determine the pressure and temperature, we also can determine how deep those metamorphic rock in the collision or subduction zone, something like that.
Yes, for estimation the pressure and temperature, we use the other mineral, not only zircon. Yes, right. Yep. It's for using amphibole or something like that. But actually, the zircon is actually can also showing the degree of the metamorphic rock because the zircon growth occur in temperature between 400 degrees Celsius up to 800 degrees Celsius. That is why this is the what is calling the temperature zircon growth. So if we can predict the zircon temperature 400 degrees Celsius, then we can predict the grade of the metamorphic rock. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. And may I have one more question?
Sure.
Thank you. So it's related about the ultramafic. I'm quite interesting with because I'm working for ultramafic and kind of meta ultramafic serpentine in Taiwan. So I always wonder about how do you interpret the exhumation of those mantle rocks to the surface with the very young age. Actually, I remember you have a younger age. It's about 5 MA, I think.
Yes, actually, dating ultramafic is difficult. Yes. This is very difficult. This except if we have the garnet.
Yeah.
Yeah, if the garnet is perfect one. But if only clinopyroxene, autopyroxene on olefin, this is difficult to dating the peridotite. I mean, for the exhumation ultramafic rock, it's a different stage, what it's calling, because sometimes ultramafic rock is occurs, what it's calling. I don't know in English. Jadi kalau ultramafic itu biasanya dia karena apa namanya plastis ya, plastis. Jadi kalau bahasa Sundanya itu apa merajal itu apa ya? Bahasa Jawanya apa? Jadi apa namanya dia kena plastis dan ini jadi dia kalau kena tekanan dia cenderung kayak balon kan dia naik ke atas gitu ya. Jadi lebih plastis. Ya utama because it's more plastis than the rock. Right? If it have the kind of pressure, become like a jelly, something like that.
Yeah.
This means that it can jelly. That's why that we calling the exploded or mencotot is in bahasa Jawa, yeah. Something like that. This is the typical of the term epic of there. To assume or to uplift to the surface. Yeah.
One more. So because the is that related between the youngest age, which is 5 MA or 3 MA, something like that, with the age of exhumation of the serpentinite or ultramafic rock, something like that. I mean, is that related or is not related at all?
This study is not related actually. The ultramafic rock is a different.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. We not yet dating. We not yet analyze the ultramafic rock. But yeah. Maybe later. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Ade.
You're welcome.
Okay. Thank you, Pak Deka, for the question. That will be the last question for this discussion. And thank you very much, Pak Ade, for this very interesting presentations and very interesting discussion. Also, I hope you get support for your future research and about zircon. This is very interesting. Because there are many people want to see the results here, and because it's very important to the geology. Thank you very much. And so I will record this sessions, and then later will be uploaded to the FOSI YouTube as well. So on behalf of FOSI, we would like to thank you, and I will give this session to Melinda for the closing. Yeah, and two weeks again, we will have Pak Ade talk for the Karang Sambung Melange. Yeah. So stay tuned to FOSI. Yeah, and we are very happy to have you all. Yeah, I think that's it for me, Melinda, for the closing.
Okay, thank you, Mas Ricky, and thank you, Pak Ade. This is such a insightful presentation. So we know already the progress of the zircon from Banda Arc. And we are very sure waiting for another result as a final result from your study and research. And hopefully we can have another session for this zircon in the future. So yeah, we will having you in the next week to talk about Karang Sambung. But for next week, we will be having another talk from Dr. Colm Mervy from Bell Geospace. We will talking about the FTG technology and its role in slow in looking for hidden place in Indonesia. So thank you very much for all of you. Thank you for joining us this afternoon, and stay safe and healthy, and see you next week. Thank you very much, Pak Ade.
Sama-sama, you're welcome.